Yeah, thank you. First of all, thanks to Flink community for giving this opportunity to talk about overall architecture in Rapido, around streaming platform. I'm Chetan. I work as a big data engineer in data team in Rapido, which takes care of data platform and data sets in KDS and Google Cloud Platform. I was in a situation was I was not able to attend this talk, but thanks to Anna, I made it. First, at a glance, Rapido is a bike taxi company. It is largest bike taxi company in India, operating in more than 100 plus cities. Rapido is not just bike taxi. TC. There are services like Rapido Buy, food delivery services, and there are things like Rapido Local. Now let's talk about focus on data team, data platform. So our data platform stack consists of major open source platform. Our data platform has evolved more since our data has joined, and we keep on optimizing it. As you can see, our data platform has all kind of from streaming to orchestration or batch systems, even in machine learning pipelines. Machine learning frameworks like TensorFlow and even metadata or data governance like Apache Atlas and Amundsen, or infra and automation stack from Vault to ELK. And there is GCP components also we use from Dataproc, GCS, etc. Yeah. Now, starting with data apps, like we have various data apps in our platform. One of such is ETO. ETO is means estimated time to an order, which is a Captain related app. Captain is the one who is also a rider. Captain basically requests go to an app and request for forecasted wait, like request when in, if we stay in this location or what time we will get the order. So this estimated time of order is an application which forecasts the wait time prediction if East go likely to stay at this current location. So this uses both historical and real time parameters to arrive at the prediction. We used Prophet to do forecast or demand forecasting in here. Talking about the architecture of this one, it starts with CleverTap. CleverTap is a mobile marketing platform which helps with user behavior analytics. You can think of this as a clickstream kind of thing. We get all the user events, and then whether it is real-time stream or batch stream, it will be ingested into the MemSQL. MemSQL is a distributed relational SQL database. Then what happens is the pipelines is batch pipelines, which are triggered by the Airflow. These pipelines will read the futures, and once the prediction is done via Prophet, the prediction will be pre-cached into the Redis for respective access. Then whenever the captain or a rider request for the ETO in the particular X, it routes via Kong or cloud load balancers to the ETO service. ETO service will fetch the precached prediction and other data which is required from MemSQL and other services. Then it will give the result to the users. Here we, since the ML serving, we went with batch predictions because it is like 15 minutes X wise predictions, so we can easily pre-cache them, and it can be served to various captains at scale. And then next, talking about another end app, that is NDL. NDL is like for captains requesting what are the demand areas. If he is in particular latitude or longitude or in a particular X location, if to which area if he goes, he will get an order. I mean, captains have questions like, where do I go to get an order? or should I stay in this area or should I go to some other place? So this is another machine learning model, application, which is also based on both historical and real-time futures to get the predictions. So this gives intelligent prediction based on the like demand, what is the local phenomenon based on local phenomenon. And now, so as you can see in the map, there is red axis and as well as yellow axis. So if it as it is red means it is an high demand area, or yellow means it is low demand area. As the color get lighter, the demand is also very less. Now, like there are a lot of other apps also. One of them is an iPricing. iPricing means intelligent pricing. So dynamically, say a price setting based on multiple real time or historical components to stabilize the marketplace. Everyone likes talks about search pricing. I think it's one of the most talked around topics in taxi marketplace. And everyone knows what kind of challenges in streaming platform is required, etc. The second picture in here is a dispatch related problem. So dispatching is one of the critical levers in any ride taxi, because for every time a customer requests for a ride, this routes through the dispatch. For every dispatch or every ride call, this routes via iDispatch systems. So these the room for error is very low in these systems. In all of these applications, Flink is one of the critical component. So let's talk about how deployments has changed in Rapido. At first we started with a Google Data Proc. Google Data Proc is a managed solution by GCP, which allows us to leverage open source projects like Apache Spark, Hadoop, or Flink in Data Proc workers. And also it allows us to use GCP related products like GCS, etc. So we started with Flink in Data Proc. To use Flink in Data Proc, we have to use initialization actions. Like initialization action is a script, a executable script, which installs all the required requirements. As you can see in the picture, there is a flink.sh. It installs Flink in master node. Flink job manager in the Data Proc master node. Zookeeper is also installed via component, optional components, which helps the Flink cluster in leader election and also serves as a consistent storage. Task managers are installed in the Flink workers. So this stack was mostly around 1.5 years ago. We have evolved, before talking about that, earlier we used to be a multi-cloud, we used to use AWS, GCP, and DigitalOcean. So there was a lot of public IPs, and developers used to SSH into the machine whenever they need to do some debugging or in the most of the cases. So when we started migrating all our workloads into one environment, one cloud, GCP, few things got changed. So same applies to Flink jobs also. Before, earlier, resource creation was resource provisioning was manual. What happens is, instead of manual provisioning of the resources for Flink or any applications, it moved to infrastructure as a code via Terraform and manual server configuration to configuration management. Similarly, manual builds and deploying via scripts or copying the jars to continuous integration and via CI/CD, manual testing to automated testings, and also DB migrations also, and DB creations, everything is automated via Terraform. So Terraform also gives us an option to view what are the changes going on via Terraform plan, so we can analyze and make changes to the production as well. Sorry, one second. Yeah, so Terraform, like with just few, like once we write a module, with just few changes, we can deploy a duplicate environment. It also allows us to do blue-green deployments. So blue-green deployment is an architecture involving two duplicate environments. This can also be done for both Flink clusters or Flink jobs, but this is out of scope for this talk maybe. Anyway, so this is one example of a Dataproc Terraform. So to create a Dataproc cluster using Terraform, you can see in the line number 364, there is a Flink initialization script. As I explained, this does the same thing. It installs the HA Flink in the Dataproc with GCS acting as a HDFS, and for state point, save point, state for everything, GCS acts as this one. But there are problems with Dataproc. One of the problems may be there are a lot of pre-installed packages like iWadoo, Spark, which consumes resources, and to run a Flink cluster, we might not need all these things. So, and also there is a pricing problems. And as I explained before, triggering the task problems, and no auto scaling is also only Dataproc supports auto scaling for Apache Spark for now. So we choose Kubernetes. Kubernetes is anyway the popular choice for everyone now. We can easily deploy simple apps or clusters like Flink cluster. We can roll out new releases without having any downtime, like task managers can be installed via rollout, or we can scale up and down the services. It is self-healable as well. And you can easily extend the APIs or create new custom resources using operator SDK or any SDKs. So standard session cluster is the one we started with in the Kubernetes, where job manager deployment will be there. There are like two deployments. One is for job manager, another is for task manager, and there will be job manager service via which we will be contacting to the job manager. Or there are config maps for logging, Flink configuration, state management, and I availability is via Zookeeper, which is and storage configs, or and also Prometheus metrics. So to talk about Flink on Kubernetes, we'll have to talk about how our infrastructure stack is around Flink cluster in KDS. So to mainly focus, I will be mainly focusing on five things. One is how the Flink is accessing GCS service APIs. So, and how the Flink configuration and secrets are managed, and how are the logs are processed, and logging stack and monitoring stack, and automations with CI/CD pipelines first. So, KDS pods to talk to GCS, we use a GCP's workload identity. GCP workload identity helps you to create a Google service account and bind them to Kubernetes service account. So any pods which are running in KTS, which are using the same binded Kubernetes service account, can easily access the GKE or GCloud APIs. So if you decide to use workload identity, you have to make sure in GKE workload identity is enabled, and it has a valid key workload identity, which mostly will be the project. For example, here chetanuk.staging.svc. Similarly, it will be your project ID SVC. And then in the node pools which you create, you need to enable the GKE metadata server. If you are using Terraform, you can do something similar to this. in the node pool, like Flink main node pool and the Flink preemptible node pools, you have to enable the node metadata with GKE metadata server. This will go ahead and apply the enabling the GKE workload identity in those node pools. After that, you need to bind the KATS service accounts with GCP service account. That I will be talking a bit about in the demo, one of the demos maybe. For configuration management, for example, if you have any Cloud SQL proxy passwords or Kafka IPs, you need to have a centralized config and secret management. So for that, we use HashiCorp console as the key value store and Vault for storing the secrets. All the configs are stored in the Git via Git crypt. Secrets are encrypted and committed. Before any job, Flink job is getting deployed, in the init container, the configs are read. There is a inbuilt in-house built tool written in Go language, which will read, validate, and apply the changes to the configs. So for example, you can see here, what is the current value on the server? What will be the new value in the server? Are we good to go ahead with this? While merging the PR, we will be making sure that, or while deploying the configs, we'll be making sure the values are correct. So there won't be any prod issues. Now coming to logging stack, we use direct straightforward EFK stack. FluentBit acts as is the open source log processor and a forwarder, which collects and push logs to Kiba, Elasticsearch. And then Kibana is for checking the dashboards or querying the Elasticsearch. Then logging stack is also, we are using a Prometheus operator within KATS and Grafana to view the dashboards or to visualize and query a few things like what is the checkpoint size or any job or cluster related metrics. Then comes CI/CD. We use GoCD as the CI/CD tool. GoCD is an open source CI/CD server, which allows us to visualize complex workflows with ease. And it also has a native Kubernetes integration. That means it runs an agent as a pods. Whenever a pipeline is triggered, it starts one agent. Whenever we merge a PR, the pipelines will be triggered for build, then test pipelines. Once it is passed, test pipelines will and then deploy them using ads. So to give you an overview, whenever a developer makes a Flink job change, merges the PR into GitHub branch, the CI/CD pipeline, that is GoCD, trigger the pipe, and then the code will be tested in the next stages. After tests are passed, Docker containerization happens, and it pushes the Docker images into GCR. Via KTS job, KTS job will be deployed by Elm chart, in the init container, what happens is Go tool go and fetch the console and configuration and secrets from console and Vault. Then it will be deploying the job to KTS Flink cluster. So as you can see, the deployments in this way are way more consistent. And even if something goes wrong, we can easily roll back the changes since all the images and stays available in CD. With the infra and action, the full process happens seriously automated. Now, so basically operators aim to put operational knowledge of how we operate Flink cluster or any software into the operator itself is a piece of code. Basically it is running in pod in the same cluster. It keeps interacting with the Kubernetes API server. Whenever it receives an event, it basically put it into a reconciliation loop to ensure that cluster is up and running. So for example, control loop, to explain control loop, let's consider about the event which says you have to scale down a Kafka cluster maybe. So first of all, it observes what is the desired state for our object, our Kafka cluster. So desired state says it needs two replicas, but it checks the difference between what is the desired state and what is the current state. So in the current state, it has three replicas. So then the difference is we have to delete a replica, right? Scale down a replica. So it takes an action. So it takes an action to make sure that current state matches the desired state. So once the action is taken, like deleting the replica is done, this loop will keep on happening. The operator keeps listening for the events. So whenever the informer or an event, it gets an event, it go ahead and do the same loop, observe, check for the differences, and take an action to make sure it is in desired state is matching with the current state. So there are many Flink on K8s operators from Lyft, and there is Kudo operator, and there is Google Cloud operator. Google Cloud operator looks promising for us since it can also allow us to run Beam jobs and all. So that's architecture is mainly there is an Flink controller, and there is an job cluster. So once we install an operator, it installs a custom resource definition called Flink cluster. So it keeps listening for the same Flink cluster's events. And whenever there is an event, the reconciliation loop, which I explained just before, starts, and it continuously observes for the state of the Flink clusters. It takes action to make sure that it matches the desired state. Maybe I will try to I am sharing the screen, just a minute. So I will try to explain how the operator works with one example. So I will try to give an demo of the Flink operator. See, as you can see, it started with the observe the current state once it. So sorry for that. So once I applied a kubectl deploy Kubernetes job, it received the webhook. After that, it started to observe the current state. Then it observed that job manager deployment is null, and then this is also a null, and then currently there was no jobs in the, there is no cluster with the name word count. So what it does is, since there was no status change, then it started to find out what's the desired state for the cluster. Then it has to take actions, and the reconcile request is started. Just a minute. So basically what happens is, it observed for the current state, then deployment was not found, cluster change, state change happens. It takes actions like configuration maps will be created, and then creating the deployment for Flink task manager, Flink job manager, then the services will be created. Yeah, since you can see that the deployment is not found for job manager, and then okay, it is still not able to. I will, 1 second. Yeah, so the same thing, basically it find out that there was no deployment found for job manager, and then it starts to creating the job managers, task manager service. Once it finds that the deployments are created, basically the reconciliation loop, once it meets the desired state to current state, there will be a Flink job submitter which will be starting once these are ready, course are ready. Yeah, so this is a Flink job submitter. So job submitter will go ahead and use the REST APIs to submit the job. And then it will keep polling for the job, whether jobs is done. I mean, if it job has reached the end state, whether it's failed or whether it is succeeded, successfully run. Once jobs execution is done completely, it will go ahead and delete all the resources. Yeah. So since it is completed, all the resources are deleted, and the job was terminated. Okay, so we also have the first one I explained was in ETO, and we have many ETL pipelines as well running with Beam. So this slide shows the evolution of an Apache Beam, and then what is the Beam model like? Is asking the right questions like what, where, when, and how. So shows the Beam vision, you have multiple runners, multiple programming languages, and then there is, yeah, so here there is a portable protos are nothing but a representation of the portable protos are pipeline representation and are language agnostic. It can then be submitted to any cluster, whether it is data flow or Flink. At initial, like 1.5 years ago, we were using Google Cloud Data Flow. Google Cloud Data Flow is another managed solution from GCP, which comes with cloud logging, monitoring, and then it can easily automatically rebalance or optimize the workload across it works the job completed, it will go ahead and all the resources the day, but with data runs project, most of the infra is in. So even if you wanted to use this now, this is not a solution due to data limits or cloud cost. Like it will be involving egress of data across, so it will be increasing egress, etc. And then the TK will for the presentation, which is language agnostic, and then it can be translated into fat jar. Yeah. So then it can be translated into fat jar. So SDKs basically has portable runners, which is kinky. I mean, SDK harness can be running as in Docker images or Docker containers or as a processors, if or also as the same, or it can be running as a KTS worker pool as a side containers. So SDK harness basically has a job of taking care of like which UDFs to run, like user defined functions to run and when to run them, and takes care of movement of data between portable runner and the SDK harnesses. Care of the management of user state or side inputs, even logging. Slides are not moving. Sorry. Yeah. Okay.
So when the users pass into the Jarvis, so here, I mean, SDK will go ahead and create the Flink proto representation. Then Flink job will be submitted to the Flink cluster. Each, as you can see, each task manager in K8s will be having sidecar containers, which is going to execute the Python code or Beam's Python side of it. Sidecar containers, but the majority of the K8s need jar to, I mean, except to fat jars. Since operators mainly, since operators only accept jobs in form of executable jars, if Beam can also build self-contained executable jar, so we can take the self-contained executable jar and then go ahead and use any of our existing CLIs or even a Flink REST API to submit the job to the Flink cluster. So this separation is very useful. Since it will build an Uber proto fat jar, then easily the dependency will be reduced, and architecture will look something similar to this. So we have in a fat jar, which can be stored in any staging locations like S3, GCS, anywhere. And then using a Flink REST API, we can directly submit that into the Flink job manager. Then same thing happens, like it will, the task managers have same sidecar containers. The sidecar containers are nothing but worker pools, which can be one or more pods. So I will be showing one demo of how this is going to work, like how we also use the ETL pipeline. Normally, all the pipeline builds happens via CI/CD tools like GoCD. For the demo purpose, I will deploy and actually there was a lining wide container. Sidecar containers are nothing but the sidecar containers runs along main container. Sidecar containers aims against the functionality of the pre-existing container. That is, in this, for example, Beam workers enhance the functionality of the of executing Python jobs without disrupting the current available Flink jobs. Yeah. So I will try to show a demo wherein of an ETL kind of pipeline, starting from a MongoDB as a source, and it will be reading and transforming a bit and pushing the data into in the Parquet format into GCS. Then the Presto, using Presto, it will be creating a table and reading those data. So Presto is another open source project which we use, which is a major component in our platform as well. It mainly allows to access any data with SQL. It comes with storage and compute separation, so we can flexibly scale storage and compute independently. You can access any data in real time. Like if you are connecting to something like MemSQL, you can directly access the data as well. It also has a security integrations like Apache Rangers, and it is very, there are a lot of optimizations like cost-based or query optimizations. So yeah, we'll be showing a demo right now. For the demo purpose, I will be using this collection. So this is a simple collection with very few data. And It has only like 30K documents. Yeah, actually now we use Elm chart so that there is post hooks to delete the jobs. Once they are done as well, but for this demo purposes, I am just using. So this is a simple pipeline wherein it go ahead and read from MongoDB. With a simple filter like city equal to Cleveland. These filters can be any filter as well. And then it does the flattening of the zip collection. So it get the ID and removes the object ID from it. So the output will be just the inside string. And then flattening the location. So location will become log of X. And then this similar for Y, log of Y. So just simple flattening logic here. And then writing it into Parquet in with codec of Gzip into GCS basically. Clean will be job, KDS bad job. Is trying to build the artifacts from Maven repo. Then it will start an artifact local artifact server. Once it builds, yeah. So now it's using the REST API, it submitted the jobs to the Flink cluster. It is submitting, it will be submitting in a bit. So portable runner job is started and running right now. One thing with Beam is the UI representation of job can be improved. But still, as you can see, every IO read starts with an impulse. Impulse is nothing special. It gives one signal, exactly one signal. After that, it starts the read function. So all the read functions are nothing but a do, I mean, do functions, do fn. It will parallelly read. And so since I gave in this one, that is a filter. Yeah. So the filter, if I apply filter to MongoDB, it's around just 34 records. So as you can see in the UI, it read from MongoDB like record is that, and then it sent to the map like it sent to the map function, and then it was returned to GCS to verify. It wrote a zip packet file. Now we go ahead and connect to the Presto server. Function. It is saying the data types and the columns, location, and what are the tables. Everything else is a varchar. The location is sorry. Yeah, and then it's saying the format is this one. So if you have partition, then you might need to call sync metadata to sync the partition or just add the IO partition. So then this is how level ETL job can be done. Similar way we are using in many pipelines. Now if you want, you can even read this using any normal JDBC clients. My internet it's running in here, so it's quite unstable today. Sorry for that. So whichever is the dependent pipelines for creating a KPIs or whatever, you might need to read the same Presto table and then do some calculations or map transformations, and then etc. Right. So for that, just showing another demo with simple Scala in here, and I mean reading from the return table, created table right now, and then just writing back with simple transformation in here is filtering for if it is void state, otherwise also is demonstrating if the count of is 17 or like, I mean if in the 34 records is 17 void state and 17 non-void. Yeah, there are 17 void states, right? So it should match. This is using simple SEO pipeline. It starts with JDBC read options. It go ahead and read from connection. Fresh driver class is initiated there, and then it go ahead and query from the created Presto table, and then row mapper is there. Then simple, after the JDBC select option is done, mapping and then simple transformation, any transformation you will have or filters, and then writing it into sync. Can also be run Flink again. You just put the skip demo altogether. Yeah. There is one more demo. Actually, I planned to do TFX end-to-end demo, but I was not able to get time for the like fitting one. So I will show a simple transformation of scikit-learn's one. Just a minute. So this is also another simple pipeline wherein it is going to read from the packet, read from the read from GCS, and then do just simple one-not encoding from the scikit-learn, calling the one-not encoder. And applying, once the transformation is done, it returns the result. We'll be writing that into GCS as a Parquet files again. So I applied the YAML file wherein it is using this GCS, this image, and then calling scikit-learn transformation pipeline with Flink runner, and Yeah, actually, this has already completed. I was connecting to wrong Flink cluster. I read the records, and then transformation happened and wrote the records to GCS as well. Yeah, I had a demo of this one as well, but it's time not available right now. Yeah, that's all. Thank you. That's it from my side, actually. I was mostly not making this task. I mean, I was not going to present this presentation because of the situation in family, like with COVID and all. But thanks to Anna, I was able to make this one. Thank you all. If there is, I will try to, there are a few questions I can see, like demo project, can you share? Yeah, I will be sharing the link after some time.